Right now, they market hip hop as a thug thing. Like, yeah, I bust a cap and I push keys and me and my Lex and my Tech Line. And so, you know, the B-boys left out.
The heads would not understand if I told them the importance of breaking culturally. Heads over the head.
No doubt, because you got a lot of new kids in there. They don't know about old school, or they claim to be old school. They be fronting. You know what I mean?
I can't really say I invented it because it was a couple of us that really invented it in school, 6th, 7th grade.
And because it's a real art form, it lives through the bad times of it.
It's almost like the Bible, you know. Eventually, man, you gotta go back to the original scripture and the original language it was written in. And I think that everybody in the East and the West Coast need to redefine our dance and then take control of it again.
And the intensity of b-boying, and then just the intensity of our situation in the ghetto. All of that piled into one. When you look at b-boying, it makes sense. It's like, okay, I can see where this is coming from. It's a lot deeper than just, well, this is fun and I think it may start out as that.
And getting noticed for the culture of it, not because it's a street dance and it's gonna always stay in the streets.
I think people need this. There's no way you cannot need this in society right now. Coming from the ghetto where everyone think it's so negative, and we're doing something positive, you know what I'm saying? How can that not become big? Or how can that not become respected in society?
We did the first shows and set the foundation what has become an industry now. Mm-hmm. And we ain't getting no love. Why is that?
B-boys.
B-boying is like the ultimate body manifestation of hip-hop. Not only do you have your feet moving, your hands moving, you're using every single part of your body, your head, your neck, your intellect, and also your character.
It's like a charge that I get. It's kind of equivalent to the excitement you get from watching a basketball player coming down. He's about to do an incredible move, and you just, it's like you create this tension and you release it. And visually, it's exciting.
It's an incredible dance. I mean, who in a million years would have thought, like, wow, spinning on your head, or, you know, doing windmills, having your feet kick up and propel. Who would have thought that a person could spin on one hand?
It's not a trend. You cannot say it's a trend anymore. It's a legitimate art form.
You can't just do it 2 hours a day and, okay, I'll do it when I go to the gym. We used to eat, piss, shit, drink, think, b-boying.
Whenever you heard Sex Machine, Just Begun, Apache, for any real b-boy, they were feeling it in their body and it would just make you dance, even if you didn't feel like dancing.
To me, it's about music, and it's about what music does to people. Music is what makes me develop my styles and my moves. The record that comes on makes me feel a certain way, and that's the way I feel when I dance.
Breaking is always, it's hip-hop, straight up.
Hip-hop is the name of our creative intelligence.
Hip-hop is a culture that started in the boogie down Bronx.
Hip-hop's are different elements dealing with music, rap, graffiti art, b-boys, what you call break boys, or b-girls, what you call break girls, and also dealing with culture and a whole movement dealing with knowledge, wisdom, and understanding, as well as peace, unity, love, and fun.
Hip-hop is beautiful to me because it always challenges America's notion of what they believe young, disenfranchised people to be. Like, these people us, who are supposed to be like just the bottom of society, not know anything, not have like one good idea, come up with like breaking.
I think it really started out of a few brothers or sisters that just didn't care what people thought, you know, just responded to these breaks.
Kids with no money, living in the ghetto, living in urban environments, living in the projects, creating a multi-billion dollar industry.
Hip-hop has progressed from when it was just B-boys and B-girls and DJs and rappers to now an international phenomenon.
All these other rap artists started coming around and started making money. I'm thinking, wait a minute, what about Kool Herc? He was the one who started this whole thing.
Kool Herc is the godfather of hip-hop. When we say of hip-hop, we mean the whole rim of things, because he did graffiti.
Yeah.
He brought the music, and his crew did the dancing. So when they say he's the godfather of hip-hop, they actually mean he's the godfather of hip-hop.
Definitely is.
When Kool Herc gave a party, everybody be there.
And if you search the history, anybody would know that the first big DJ was Kool Herc. You know, we used to all go to Herc's parties. We used to dance at Herc's parties.
When I was about five or six years old, I used to listen to Herc play. He used to play at Sedgwick Avenue in the Bronx. I lived in 1600 Sedgwick Avenue in the Bronx, the building right next door. But I could never go. But I would always just keep in the back of my mind this obscure kind of scene that I wanted to be involved in and wanted to be down with. He was starting hip-hop.
We followed Herc every fucking where Herc went. Herc was the man, you know, because Herc had the shit. And Herc had the atmosphere. I mean, really, there was nothing like a Kool Herc party.
We heard the music from way down the block. We were, you know, Herc had the big speakers. We walked down the block. Closer we got, the louder the bass got. And all we could hear is this tall, light-skinned guy going,
"If this is DJ Kool Herc, and you always come back for more."
And we used to rent this for $25. Half the party was inside and half was outside. That's how packed it got. Till one summer, I gave up the first block party right here between the buildings. And that told me where my career was heading, where the clientele was heading. We couldn't come back here. That was it. That was the birth of hip-hop, man.
Herc used to play a part of a record that had a breakdown in it. And that's why they call the records breakbeats. Now, it was a part of any record that had a breakdown where all the music dropped out and it was just a beat. And these beats were so hype and so frantic that when the music dropped out and it was just a beat, everybody would go off.
And I noticed people used to just wait for those particular part of the record. And I started buying two records. I started prolonging the records, the breaks. For instance, James Brown, coming to clap your hands, stomp your feet, clap your hands, stomp your feet. I get another one to extend that part, clap your hands, clap your hands.
We used to always, when we were in a circle, wait for the break of the record. That was it. We would get down to the break of the record.
I call that particular part of the music the merry-go-round, because I'm going to take the merry-go-round back and forth, giving you no slack.
The break of the record, B, break. We are the B Boys.
Word B Boy originated from Kool Herc. B Boys really stood for Bronx, or really breaking boys, because, you know, when people would be breaking at the party, you know, starting trouble.
B Boys and B Girls break beats. Break boys, break girls.
I can tell you straight up, the terminology breaking comes from a street terminology. When people just say, "Why are you breaking on me? Why my mom's breaking on me? Why are you acting crazy?" It really just meant doing shit above normal.
The DJs used to cut breaks, and the B-boys would break to what? The breaks. So, well, you know, it's just common sense, man.
You know, when somebody get mad, yo, he's breaking, stop breaking, man. And if Kool Herc says it, it's official.
Break it down.
B-boy. Boy, that break. It didn't come from breaks on the record. It come from this man, he broke. He went to a point of a breaking point. You understand? So we just use that exaggeration of that term to the dancing. The B-boys, break boys.
breaking goes back, as far as I know, talking to founders of the dance, no later than 73. And these are breakers who used to break mainly on top.
It was like a whole new movement, like a, just like a spontaneous thing that just happened in the party.
Certain styles of dances came out that you knew was the new dance and you did it. But with breaking, burning, and going off, other people that liked it would adapt it, and that became like that agenda.
You knew how to do it. You just come in, you know, you do your little posturing and posing, and, you know, and then you go down, and then, like, if you're doing a good move, then people will gather around, so then you got a little circle, and somebody might get in there and challenge you.
All back here was lit up with music. And this is where a lot of people start dancing at. Put a speaker right out here. Everybody having fun? Come on there. All out of crazy stuff.
Because you see all this shit come together. Then you got people like the Nigga Twins, all of a sudden they going down to the floor.
It was one of the brothers that used to be down with Kool Herc, and he had like a little spin move where he would like do that little spin move. And that was actually the first time I ever seen somebody, you know, go down on the floor.
We saw people dancing and we wanted to dance. You know, and it's just that our style of dancing was not like anybody else's.
Funny thing was, the Nigga Twins used to always have straws in their mouth.
The Nigga Twins used to come in with cigars and trench coats, and they used to come in and split the place up and act like Groucho Marx, and they used to walk in with the cigars and then meet up in the middle.
When we used to go down on the floor, we didn't get dirty. And we didn't dance on linoleum, we didn't dance on cardboards, we danced on the cement.
Them was the real B-boys from back in the days, you know what I'm saying?
Original Top Rock isn't the Top Rock that they do now. It goes like this. That was the original Top Rock. It wasn't like this. You know what I mean? And there was the Indian step that looked like this. I up rock
was straight up B-boy up rock. Straight up B-boy.
B-boying on the floor didn't come out to like maybe the ending of 74, 75. Where people actually started going down and breaking on the floor.
I don't know who did it, but eventually somebody went down and stayed down. So from up rocking, I brought it to the floor. You know, that's why I was so good, because I was, from there on, it just kept going. Bruce and them brought it out to the Bronx River. Before you know it, there was Zulu King. Word up.
It was really a combination of sweeps, CCs, which is the side-to-side movements when you're facing front, and steps like the Russian, which look exactly like a Russian. You cross your arms and you kick front. Steps were a lot more basic, and it looked a lot more... If there's a B-boy out there that I would compare old style to, the real old style is Frosty Freeze. When you see Frosty in like flash dance and old footage of him, and sometimes he still does it today, when you see his footwork, it doesn't look complete. That looked more like what the original B-boys looked like back in the day.
They used to do a style that I hardly see anyone do, which is more like jerky type of, it wasn't like a like six step, you know, this right. Is how it goes. It was a little more sporadic and wild spirit, like boom, whip, freezing, ha, blah, blah, you know what I'm saying?
And then with the godfather of hip hop, myself, Afrika Bambaataa, you had what you call the Zulu Kings.
I grew up watching more like the Zulu Kings, Beaver. Beaver was like the biggest name in B-boying, period. I mean, you couldn't find nobody better than Beaver until Spy came along and blasted him with Track 2 and the brothers. Everything, all the breaking and stuff like that was considered underground. And so Kool Herc brought everything out into the open. And that was like, say, 74, 75. All the underground stuff, all the in-house, all the hallway dances, and all the house party dances were brought out to the street. And the more they took it to the street, the more nationalities got involved in it. You know, it was no longer an Afro-American thing. The Hispanic took to the dance.
I know for a fact that when I went to some parts, it was rare to see a Puerto Rican dancer breaking. And when they did, it was like, oh shit, check out the Puerto Rican B-boy, you know?
A lot of people used to call it like, yo, you know, like the Latinos, you know, Moreno means black, you know, they'd be like, yo, that's that Moreno style, you know, and that's the original style of B-boying.
So black kids
invented breaking as we know it, as we understand it. It was the Puerto Rican kids that put breakers on their backs.
Batch is one of the first Hispanic breakers ever.
Don't forget, I'm 35 years old, eh?
Salso was the crew where basically we all came out of. The first all-Hispanic breaking crew. After Salso, Batch started up the TBB crew, and they were a big crew.
We was one of the best breakdancing crews out there. And I believe that, you know, up to today's date, if I would not kept going to jail, you know, and a lot of my people getting killed and going to jail as well, we could have probably been one of the big industry today out here making money.
Swipes in the air that you see legs do. That was originated by my partner, Spy, who I considered the best breaker I have ever seen break.
Brushed ink, dust, ink, rust.
That's undisputable. I mean, whoever knows breaking, that name has to come up.
Yes, I'm a man with a thousand.
This shit's hot, nigga.
He's one of the first B-boys ever, and he was known as the man with a thousand moves, and his name is Spy. So I want to bring him up here so y'all can see. Come on up here, man.
Spy was a legend to me because he was already called Man with a Thousand Moves. I used to always go to Mom and Pop's social club or nightclub, whatever you want to call it. It was a basement, really, on Crotona Avenue. And I used to go there a lot to try to see Spy. And then one day I saw Spy there, and I saw him. I'll never forget. He had this red hat on, and his afro was just like poofing right out the side. His hat was to the side, just like this. And that's why whenever I go down right now, whenever I start breaking, I got a hat on, you know, this is just like straight Spy. This is the Spy in me, you know what I mean?
When they would tell me stories about Spy, I would look in the sky and be like, trying to picture myself with it, trying to put myself there, you know, like in the gymnasium, in the church. And when I saw him break, I was like, wow, you know? It's just like this energy around a person, you know what I'm saying? There's an energy around people that, you know, the stories are the stories, there's a reason why they're being said. There was an energy around him, he was mad clean and mad smooth. It was just like he didn't have to do anything really incredible. He did whatever he did, it looked sweet.
Track two was like little ladies man back then.
You know, track two, that at one point they said he was the best.
JoJo and them used to be off the hook, for real. They used to be like traveling. They was like gypsies in a way, cause they used to find out wherever they jamming at, go there, and whoever was dancing over there, they would knock them off, for real.
Them boys were just so incredible. They were like stars coming out. These brothers would come out dressed, you know, not like bums, like a B-boy was. Usually you're all bummy dressed. These guys would be dressed nice, but boom, they'd come out and they were like stars. Yo, there goes JoJo, there goes Spy, there goes Jimmy D. There goes all of this track two right there with his big old track nameplate. Those are the brothers that made up the moves. All the moves that you see nowadays come from the root of those people.
Like 79, late 78. By then, a lot of black brothers weren't really dancing anymore.
The disco scene killed breakdance. In the disco scene, the DJ couldn't throw in no beats. He had to keep that. So for him to throw in a patch, he would disrupt the dance floor and he'd get fired.
I mean, you couldn't really ask a girl to dance and she'd be like, yeah, and then you'd be like, you know what I'm saying? She ain't trying to feel that.
When I started doing my shit in 77, by the time 79 came around, I had brothers looking at me like, yo, why you doing that? That's played out.
I used to hustle, and I used to practice by myself because I didn't dare cut in with the girls, thinking that a girl might be, oh, who's you, you know? So I used to just take to the floor, and I took all my aggression. They didn't notice me for my hustling abilities. They were gonna notice me for my breaking abilities.
Rocksteady Crew started in 77. A lot of its members were like all-star B-boys from the Bronx. The guys that started Jimmy D and JoJo, they hung out on at 115 Park in the Bronx.
We came up with the word Rock Steady. We started thinking because we want to continue dancing. We wanted to keep it at a steady pace.
You know, when they started doing it, a lot of people called it rocking, going off. And what they wanted to do, you know, they noticed that a lot of people were stopping around 76, 77. And, you know, they wanted to keep it going on. You know what I'm saying? They wanted to keep the rock steady. And when they started getting too old for it and it started dying down with them, they passed it along to Legs.
In 79, I moved to Manhattan. 1979, a lot of B-boys were locked down, doing stick-ups, whatever, murders, or went away to Job Corps, or just got regular jobs. Retirement age for a B-boy back then was like 16, 17 years old. When I moved to Manhattan, I used to always try to come back to the Bronx and go over to jams, do whatever I can to get back on the weekends, stay over on Katona Avenue.
Between the summer of 76 and 77, me and my friends, we had a crew called the Rock City Crew. And then like around 79, the dance started fading out. I still kept on, but the only time I would go down is if I seen somebody else. And then my cousin Ty Fly, he introduced me to Ken Swift and his crew called the Young City Boys.
My crew, we were just like mischievous. We used to do things like going throw, there's a, down the alley, there's a precinct right straight there. We used to throw eggs at the police and run.
They were like, you know, 3 or 4 years younger than me, so I looked like a big kid of them. But, you know, I told them anytime y'all have any battles coming up, you know, I'll take your side.
I got down Rocksteady when I battled Legs, and then a lot of my crew got down Rocksteady.
And Mr. Freeze was part of Rocksteady in the Bronx already.
The only white boy I knew that was a B-boy is Mr. Freeze. He was the only white boy, the first white boy in the Bronx. With Juice, he could go in any black Puerto Rican neighborhood and walk through and say, I'm Mr. Freeze, Rocksteady crew. He was like, oh, yo, you're cool, man.
Me and my cousin 99, we were traveling all over the place, battling people, and then just like start hanging out with them. When you hang out with those people, they might know someone that might be breaking in another area. Like, all right, cool, let's go over there. I want to battle them. It's like the martial arts films where it's like, I heard your style is good, but mine is better. And you go there and you test their style. And that was my way of recruiting.
Our crew was called the Rock City Rockers, man, from the 173rd Street area. We were battling, we would do it for fun because there were really nobody in our area that we, you know what I mean, that were really involved until we met up with a guy called Crazy Legs. I was like, oh man, yeah, I want to adapt that style, man. That's why my name is Little Crazy Legs.
That's basically how I met everyone else that ended up being in Rocksteady.
You know, I met up with Frosty Freeze, he knew people, Take One knew people, Ken Swift, Mr. Wiggles, then you had my peeps from Alcatona, Toxic, A1, we just had like 500 members of Rocksteady.
Well, that was real good. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Johnny J is my name.
Yeah.
Frosty Freeze, please.
First times I met Rocksteady and we did something together, Henry Chalfant, legendary graffiti photographer, documentarian, got together with the Rocksteady crew, because so many graffiti artists used to come to Henry's studio to look at his photos of the trains, that he began to realize that a lot of these guys were also breakdancers. Hence, they were the Rocksteady crew. Henry knew me, he knew a bunch of other heads, and he said, listen, I wanted to have us put together like a show, and they projected the slides up of the graffiti while a Rocksteady crew danced, and I rapped, and the DJ was cutting it up. And that was reviewed in the Village Voice. The Village Voice wrote a big article on that. And from then, like, it seemed like it was on.
We started doing that. Henry Chalfant put us on. What we were doing is we were breaking up Rocksteady crew into two groups. It was Rocksteady and Breakmasters for shows. Battle each other, but it got to a point where like, yo, you know, forget this, you know, let's make it interesting. And we were hooked up with a show at Lincoln Center. Henry Chalfant again hooked us up with that show. And it was like, yo, let's, you know, let's battle dynamic in a neutral ground now. Mm-hmm. In Lincoln Center, Manhattan, boom.
And that event was covered by National Geographic. It was came out in the front page of Metro Section in the New York Times. It was also on 2020.
And they showed it on Channel 7, ABC News. I just remember seeing legs on the news, and I was like, oh, dip, you know, like that's legs.
And at the end of the battle, they were like, who won the battle? All you heard was rock steady, rock steady, like in the middle of Lincoln Center.
One day I was watching TV, and I saw rock steady on TV, and I was like, whoa. They can do it, we can do it. So I got a group back together. I went and recruited Chino, and we started from there.
To make a long story short, we met Michael Holman, who was some type of manager to Rocksteady, and in 1982, they offered us a battle.
I had a nightclub called Negril, the first hip-hop club in downtown New York. And I invited down Rocksteady crew to perform every Thursday night. They, believe me, everybody was there. Rene Ricard, Francesco Clemente, Jean-Michel Basquiat, Keith Haring. And so here's where Negril comes in to exposing hip-hop to the rest of the world. Because New York is a media capital. Every important magazine, every important newspaper has representation in New York City. After a while, I started getting a little bit bored with just Rocksteady crew doing a dance performance. And I said, Legs, you know, what's up with this battle I keep hearing, battles I keep hearing about? I didn't really know. And after a couple of weeks, he found a crew called Four Masters.
Well, actually, they needed a crew to battle so they can look good on film. And they wanted a crew that wasn't as good as them so they could look real good on films. And what they didn't know is that the Floor Masters were real good.
You can't get fresher than this. That was fresh. You want a fresh style, let me show you. You can't get fresher than this. That was fresh. You want a fresh style, let me show you. You can't get fresher than this. That was fresh.
And when Floor Masters came down to perform, a light turned on in my head. Because what I saw was breakers who may not have been as good as Rocksteady crew in the finesse and style end of breaking. What they lacked in that, they more than made up for in the athleticism of breaking. They spun longer, faster, and harder. And I thought, that's what I want to do. I want a crew that's athletic. Like crew, that's a crew that would eventually find its way into the Olympics.
Michael Holman saw something that he felt like, wow, this is a real good thing. And you know, they changed the name from Floor Masters to New York City Breakers.
A lot of people think that if you're from New York and you're from the Bronx, that you know good. But we're from the Bronx, and we out here to show everybody that we're good. That the Bronx doesn't just got bums and ghettos, but it got something good, too. Because we're the freshest kids out there.
I had embarked with Charlie Ahern to make the first hip-hop movie, Wild Style. My main intent with Wild Style was to show that breakdancing, graffiti, and rap were one. It was connected. Nobody has seen these forms as being a part of each other. I sought to make this film to bring all these forms together in one format so people could see like how they interrelated. Everybody see, I know a rock got a lot of money.
lifestyle. That was the one movie that captured more of the true essence of hip hop. When I shock with the real rock steady crew, with the path of my feet, that makes you move. Groove it in the park one Saturday night. Yeah, the kids you need, we're ready for a fight. All the clouds in the house, shocking with a plane. They get on the dance from the joint of saying, a rock steady crew. Around that time, we was just doing it just to have fun and gain recognition. We didn't ever think it would turn out to be famous or, you know, take it worldwide.
This park right here, we basically named it Rocksteady Park because it was an essential meeting place for all the chapters of Rocksteady in the early 80s.
We used to come around here and just act up, you know. And we kind of like shared the park with everybody. Everybody knew each other.
Yeah, Rocksteady on one side of the park. Then you had all the drug dealers on this side, like people selling mescaline, loose joints. It's a carpet store now, but that's where we used to get our cardboard and bring it to the back. Prior to that, it was just basically roughing it up, concrete style, just doing our thing. And, you know, straight to cruises, cutting up the back, getting all the what we call B-boy burns on the shoulders and things like that. So many things have gone down here. I mean, you've had like the Buffalo Gals video was filmed here. Lady that was our manager at the time, Cool Lady Blue, told us that these people saw the show and they wanted us in the movie Flashdance, and that was it right there.
But do you remember what we said?
What did we say?
When she said, I'd like you to be in a movie, we were all like, no, we don't want to do a movie like that. Then everyone's going to start doing our moves, or the way we thought back then was biting. They were going to bite. And I remember like it was yesterday, it was in a dance studio. We did not want to do it. And then she said, you'll get paid. The pay is $1,038. And we were like, okay.
Didn't really talk to us there. But after the premiere on Broadway in New York, when they saw the response, the public and the press on how crazy they went when the world first saw B-Boying was through us. I mean, during the scene, the actual scene, people were going out of their minds because besides chills going through our bodies, we couldn't believe it. We were like, holy shit, we're on this screen. When we came out, the press was all over us. All of a sudden, Jennifer Beals is like, hey, hi. You know what, got in the middle with us with pictures, and we were like, yeah, exactly. We were like, whatever, get in the pictures. So, you know, she took pictures with us, that's when it kind of escalated for us.
Breaking hit the West Coast with a fury in 82.
When it came out here, it originated really from Flashdance. So when that came out, it just spread it right from that little scene, just that one scene. And everyone started doing it.
Maybe 13, 14 years old, I picked up on it quick, like everyone else. They saw it for the first time, and you know, people just knew it was part of them. So, you know, I found a couple of other brothers that felt the same way. Started up a crew called Shake City Rockers, which were influenced by New York style breakers, and we were more like into the air moves, you know what I'm saying?
I used to look up to the guys out here in the West Coast, you know, I used to look up to the Shake City Rockers, you know, Pony Express. you know, I wanted to earn it so bad, and they used to just make fun of me back then, you know, because I was like, I was so small that they wouldn't even pay attention to me. And then when I saw New York City Breakers, it was like, oh shit.
There was a lot of breakers everywhere, and we had this youth center called the Radiotron. A lot of the roughest kids from Los Angeles were kicking back at that center.
And everyone would know the Radiotron, everyone would know Caesar, Max was big, Orko was very big. Like, everyone would be here. I mean, you would see everyone from everywhere. L.A. was behind New York terribly at the beginning. What it was we were just finding spinning moves, and that's what we adopted, because that's what we saw. New York had so much style, but their spinning wasn't up to par as far as L.A. L.A. started just rising.
I mean, I'm proud to say I'm from the West Coast. We're proud of our West Coast roots. You know, we're proud of popping and locking.
Los Angeles was a real hotbed for new dance and new hot things going on.
Locking is the very first professional street dance. Locking was created by Don Camelot Campbell sometime in the late 60s. He was trying to learn how to do the funky chicken. He was like a real wildflower, right? He couldn't do it. And he stumbled onto this style of locking. I didn't meet Don until 69. I snuck away from an all-night prayer meeting. Went to this club called Maverick's Flats. And I looked, so across the dance floor, this guy doing something that was just awesome. I've never seen anything like this in my life. What is this?
Locking comes from that's locking. This is Uncle Sam Point. Everything in locking has a name. Knee drops, Uncle Sam Points, locking, wrist rolls, playing with the hat, all of that has a name.
Locking was a lifestyle. You wore certain type of clothes. You walked a certain way. You didn't look in locking. You look, or you didn't point in locking. You.
I'll start off locking. I was watching Rerun, Michael Jackson when he was doing the robot, the Jackson 5. I was watching Jeffrey Daniels, Papa Lone Kid on Soul Train, and I started trying it. You know what I'm saying? I just started jumping off chairs, trying to do the dive.
The popping movement was a combination of locking and the robot.
Breaking came from the East, but popping came from South Central to West.
Talking to Pete, who was the first one to start hitting or popping, the actual pop part of it was Fresno, California.
Popping is really, really minute. It's like this. Bam. See, that's. Popping is like, this is popping. This is popping, so you know. This is popping.
Strutting. Strutting is continuous movement in the same direction. And then it's ticking. And then hitting is this.
When I hit, it reminds me of like a gangster perspective from where I come from. So when I'm hitting like I'm getting ready to fire on you. You know what I'm saying? My hits come from the hood, you know? It didn't come from me, it came from the hood because I had that gangster vibe, you know? Real niggas wanted to see real niggas hit.
Popping and boogaloon, two different styles. Boogaloon was like really loose.
So if I'm popping here, if I'm popping, then I'm hitting, I can hit, and then I can boogaloo at the same time and move, you know what I'm saying? So boogalooing, it's like you're moving the body, you're turning, your head going, your body going another way.
Pete told me that his influences in that, besides seeing his brother, was from San Francisco. There was a group called Demons of the Mind, Close Encounters of the Funkiest Kind. Two different groups, and they used to perform at San Francisco Pier.
Yeah.
We didn't realize it later on that, yes, we were a part of the, we were part of our whole hip-hop culture.
The cultures blended a lot long time ago.
The brothers that represented the most in New York always had respect for the West Coast, always. We were obviously inspired by the styles from over there.
I mean, we were really far apart, man. And to have both of these dancers come from two distant places like that, and then come together, man, that was like, man, incredible.
This is called breakdancing, or breaking. Like rapping, it's a competitive display of style. Dance as a form of ritual warfare.
After the initial splash of breakdancing, it became a phenomenon, and it was all about breakdancing, at least as far as the media was concerned.
As soon as the man with the money said, hey, we can make money off of this here, that's when it blew up. That's when it really blew up.
When they came out with those books, place your right foot perpendicular to your left ankle.
This guy was selling cardboard. He had a company making cardboard boxes that you carry with you and open up that says the Oz Rock.
When you got on the train, there would be kids breaking. When you went to the city, it'd be just people breaking. It was just, and it was all over the place.
Guys falling out of the closets, coming from the cars, looking around. I mean, hanging from the ceiling, popping in. I mean, it was everywhere. I was like, damn, you know, oh, damn.
That's when the Olympics came. What, 4 billion people saw the Olympics?
We are the pioneers of taking breakdancing mainstream.
Ladies and gentlemen, homeboys, homegirls, the New York City Breaker.
We, the New York City Breakers, we certainly commercialized it more than any other crew did. We got it onto big shows and in advertisements.
Probably culminating with this big television show that Ronald Reagan was at. It was some big presidential performance, and they had breakdancers perform on national TV, and it was like, what is going on?
And breakdancing just spread so wide. I mean, they had cardboards on every street corner. It was like, I think it even hit more bigger than it hit in New York. And it went in every mall. Malls had to close down sometimes. They had things where kids were doing windmills, falling downstairs and getting up and hitting customers when they were shopping. It was so packed that the police would go undercover and wear undercover uniforms and just arrest kids for breakdancing.
Media just fed into it and grabbed whatever breaker they can get. They were like, well, hey, you know, if you can just do anything, we'll take you.
Make this election different. This year, vote break and make it count more and more and more and more.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is not to be believed. You're a Ken Swift, right?
Yeah.
Rocksteady traveled all over the world, and then next you know, boom, Beastie came out.
Yo, what's up? Yo, man, your biters. All your homeboys are biters. Yo, Wax, so what's up with that? Yo, what are you talking about, man? I never stole no moves from you. All your moves ain't worth it a bit. So what's up with that, punk?
Punk, who you calling punk?
And boom, Rocksteady, New York City Breakers, and Mad Force chilling in Confrance. We was bugging. We were like the young kids of the 80s, you know what I mean? The exploitation era, but it took us all over the world. We were bumping into each other's cross-continent, you know what I'm saying? And we thought we were rich and shit.
Crazy Legs and those guys were managed by a chick named Lady Blue. She had engineered them to make a record that became a number one hit in London. Hey You, the Rocksteady Crew. It was not a B-boy record. It was a pop record, but it was a number one song. And I don't think the Rocksteady Crew ever really loved the record because they were like, you know, this ain't about B-boying, but it was about putting some money in their pockets for a minute.
I started breakdancing with my friend Donovan and Mike, and we actually had a lot of those black people in Samoan, and we used to all come to my house, and my mom would wake up in the morning, there'd be like a gang of Samoans from like Carson City, hardcore, and she'd be like, what the fuck is going on here? I'm like, Mom, teach me how to spin on my head.
A lot of people, unfortunately, took it as a fad, you know?
I guess guess what was going on was the breakdancers themselves weren't in control of it. It was just a media frenzy, as oftentimes happens in this here crazy pop culture that we live in. So you just get chewed up and spit out by the media machine.
I don't know why, but the police and other people in the city and officials wanted to ban breakdancing because they felt it was a nuisance. They shut down the streets, they shut down Venice Beach before. Just, I saw a guy just do an arm wave and go to jail.
But what they did was just, you know, they put it out there and then they, you know, everybody was into it, like as far as just this the end thing. Then when the next thing came through, they kind of like kicked it to the curb.
A lot of the mainstream kids, you know, the media said, okay, it's dead, it's time to move on.
So, you know, everybody on the industry tried to get all their mileage out of it and milk it for what it's worth, rape it like they do, and move on.
B-boying did eventually die out. There's a number of reasons why, and there are people out there who kind of blame me in a way because they see myself and the New York City Breakers as being the people who took breaking from being underground and taking it and making it really huge and making it a big splash out of it, making, putting it out there in television and in films, and we commercialized it, and I'm not ashamed of that.
Here we were, 1 minute we were in the limelight, everything was straight, traveling all around the world, walk up to a club, hey, come on in, club, you help build as far as reputation, you know, and next thing you know, it's like, go to the back of the line, boom. You know, how do you really nurture someone for this industry, you know, and prepare them for what can happen, especially someone coming from the ghetto and all you see is like money. From that to having loot in your pocket, renting OJs out, getting all your boys high, and having honeys, and to next thing, just like having the rug pulled under you. Yeah, I went through the ill identity crisis.
When we were dancing and one of the guys, Matt, he got killed in a motorcycle accident. It's like, from then, it's like everything just started falling apart.
Yeah, that kind of brought us bad luck.
We didn't get any gigs, and we just kind of lost it from there. We stopped dancing.
Toward the end of 84, like, a lot of crews broke up, you know, including Rocksteady's and New York City Breakers and Dynamics.
And I think it should have never went above ground.
I don't think it was made for commercialism. I think it was designed by God to spread love between the communities. You know, there's a lot of kids that have so much energy, creative energy, you don't know what to do with it.
You know, we were doing wild things, man, but as long as I was on the cardboard, it just kept me occupied.
You were too tired to fight because you've been popping and breaking all night. You were too busy learning how to windmill than to rob and steal. Because the idle hand is the devil's workshop. So if you had so much to do, you ain't never had time to go out and do the wrong.
Imagine somebody took me and showed me how to wear a bandana, a rag or something to claim a color. I would have put the same energy into gangbanging as I did in a b-boying.
Our aggression was breakdancing, was b-boying towards another crew. You know, because before that came, there was gangs.
NWA, they came out with their versions of rap. And what they did was, it actually influenced gangsterism.
I seen the change from rap being rocking parties to rap being gangster. I was there when it changed. I was there, and I even became a part of it, trying to be a gangster, started getting tatted, started getting braids, cornrows, started sagging.
You know, I was like so disappointed with just like everything that was going on in my life with, you know, Rocksteady Crew. I just started going back to school. I got a job, you know, also going to college for a minute. And I started hanging out with some old school friends, and you know, it was my best friend. And unfortunately, they weren't into the greatest scene in the world. I was here for blow, smoking weed. I used to sell guns. I held over $1 million for a friend of mine in my crib for about 2 years.
Cash.
And I, you know, I was involved with certain things that you know, led to some of my closest friends getting killed.
you look right now at like Randy. He was from the I think he was from the LA Breakers. Kid Tough. They're all in jail. And it's like even Flo, one of the best breakers ever in New York City, which is in jail for murder right now.
But for got involved with hustling, doing his thing. Along with that game comes a lot of, you know, ridiculous beef. Sometimes there's beef, and then one person gets murdered, another person on the other side gets murdered. And eventually it got to a point where they found out where Buck lived. They caught him in his garage. And they basically kind of like tortured him and murdered him execution style.
We like to have a moment of silence. Moment of silence for that, excuse me. So everyone, if they could be quiet for a few moments, just to honor those brothers that have passed away.
Look in the street and see muggings, killings, and you say to yourself, hey, I'm doing something for this world. I'm entertaining people. That's good. That makes me feel good.
Moment of silence goes out to Kid Tough from the Domino. Kid Tough got to the point to where he was one of the best on the West Coast. I mean, one of the best. He got caught up. He ended up doing time. He got back out. He was going to start breaking. I talked to him 2 days right before it happened, and he was killed. They took breaking away from us. Gangbanging and dope dealing came in. I know everybody from here know what that means.
Want to be a gangster, want to be a thug aspect. Don't get too caught up in that. Always understand that this is entertainment, you know? You don't see Robert De Niro trying to kill Al Pacino, you know what I'm saying? Or Joe Pesci, them is actors, you dig it? Just like all these rappers is basically actors. Let's be for real here, I know.
If I lay low and let the day go, it slow my payroll. Ayo, I'ma terrorize tours to slay shows. Ride safe flows, go as far as the Barbados. On the turntable, sound like tornadoes. My topics perform like tropical storms. Yo, not to get on the whole spot to get torn. I keep the Metropolitan hollering and bring the dollars in. Keep the models following, wise as King Solomon. Come slow through the jungle like an animal. Invade any land, I go like General Hannibal. From Long Island to Queens, light up the New York scenes. All the way to New Orleans, everything in between. Left to go black. The show in Mexico. Next thing I know, extra core, I see Eskimos. Time to rock, get it high. Soon as I get in there, spit in their ear, flows they froze when I disappear.
You can go up to a businessman and say, in 85, you ever heard of breakdancing? Yeah. You ever heard of rapping? You mean rapping a gift?
All of a sudden, just died out. Rapping took over and shit.
The dancing was really what catapulted rap music into like the media's eye. And it was really the media grabbing these b-boys and saying, hey, you know, let's take these kids on tour, let's do shows, and hey, we want to bring these rap artists.
Rap had product. It had something that it could sell. It had music, it had CDs, it had records, and it's something that one could take home. You can't take a breaker home with you.
It lasted for a minute. We used to have dances for your stage show, but then after a while, it became more pop. So a lot of that phased out.
I think the MCs and the rappers out there have not really recognized what b-boying's, how b-boying opened doors for them.
When they say, yeah, I do hip hop, it's like, you know, but they're really trying to say is I rap.
The thing that Run DMC represents is the thing that's gonna not let people forget us and KRS-One, of course, not forget about that time or that era where the whole culture of hip hop was the music of hip hop, which is rap, the dance of hip hop, which was breaking, and the art of hip hop, which was graffiti. Those things all were like 3-in-1, hand in hand. Once rap became a money-dominated entity, those things fell off.
Breakdancing really didn't play out per se. It's just that, you know, motherfuckers over here is just too much of a bitch to understand what real hip hop culture is.
The music. I tell a lot of B-boys, especially a lot of upcoming B-boys, they just see a circle when they just want to get down and just exploit their mood. But I always tell them, listen to a certain beat, because that's important that when you go down, what you go down to.
I have videotapes of guys in Germany dancing to fucking Donna Summer's Bad Girls and Brooklyn rock into it. How do you Brooklyn rock to that?
Many of my b-boys around here, we always go down to the break beats. Like Apache was one of our favorite records around here. That's a b-boy anthem.
This is it. Throw on some James Brown, so just begun. You could be dressed in a tuxedo if you're a real b-boy, and you got, I don't care if it's a little bit of top rock, you're gonna do something.
Well, all he had to do, man, was put that record on, man, that Just Begun joint. And that's when it was on, man. We got busy, man.
R&B funk is the music that we dance with. If it was funky, we dance. Although we could dance to a waltz, okay?
Planet Rock. That was the popping song.
Yeah.
It wasn't exactly the breaking song, was it? Because
not at
it didn't
all.
Have that beat.
It could be a day that you feel like, well, I don't feel like catching rap today. But play one of those records and your mind will change really quick.
Damn, when I first learned about the dance in 77, it was called b-boying. By the time the media got a hold of it in like 81, 82, it became breakdancing. And I even got caught up calling it breakdancing too.
Yeah, but you know what? That's our fault, kind of.
Of course.
When breakdancing went mainstream, and we started, you know, dancing and going on tours and stuff like that, and people would say, oh, you guys are breakdancers. We never.
We had to reinvent ourselves. You see, we kept walking around calling ourselves breakdancers. They're like, ah, y'all don't kids from the 80s, man. That shit is played out. But when we started calling ourselves B-boys, it was like, what? This is a new shit.
B-boys, that's what it is. That's why when the public changed it to breakdancing, they was just giving a professional name to it. But B-boy was the original name for it, and whoever wants to keep it real will keep calling it B-boy.
Steady taking out these toys.
Yeah, no matter where you're from, no matter where you're from, yeah, no matter where you're from, no matter where you're from, everybody in the house.
I used to watch Rocksteady in the park, you know, even when I had records out, they were still in the parks and in the clubs. And in South Bronx, that's where I wrote, and the real Rocksteady taking out these toys.
We would go to clubs. We would hear like South Bronx by KRS-One. We would just start screaming South Bronx, South Bronx.
Rocksteady became the image of all breakers everywhere, all serious breakers.
That record means so much to me. KRS-One gave us a place that no one can, you know, like historically.
Say Rocksteady!
That everything springboarded from that.
Yeah.
got us more in tune, in touch with the hip hop audience again.
B-boy is dope. The original hip hop is dope.
Just when you think, like, you know, the dance is just fading away, kids somewhere else picks up on it.
Every generation has its creativity and its energy to bring to the table. It's all good.
You talk to some of them OGs who first start dancing back in the day, and you show them clips of what's going on now, they'll be like, man, I never thought it would have went to that.
This is who I am, this is what I do. If I go in a circle and I automatically start tumbling, it may not be a dance to you, but it's my dance.
Up their asses, man. These kids are doing some incredible shit. And I'm like, damn, I'm glad I paid my dues already. I'm 31. Let these kids die.
So I look at them now, and they doing a lot of beautiful things, you know, a lot of creativity, and I'll be like, oh my God, yo, you nice. Like, you see them spinning in their hand like this. Like, oh God, yo.
Now these guys are, like, spinning up in the air, masturbating, and, like, you know, catching their semen in their air. Going back down.
Radiotron, it's like the dopest shit around.
Like,
Radiotron.
Radiotron. Radiotron.
Neighborhood.
The Radiotron, Caesar just went haywire with it. He just blew up. I mean, he went all out because, you know, he's always was a strong B-boy, man. So he went out there. He said he was going to put it together.
Bringing Radiotron, I think I'm giving another outlet for the young generations to get down. You know what I'm saying? It's more like now you get creative with it. We the OGs were the ones who came out with a lot of the moves. I think that now it's our job as OGs to like maintain the movement how it really was back in the days, and let the new generation take it to another level.
An idea, you know, Styelements came about around 1995 with two crews that kind of united together. It was people from Stockton, Modesto, Sacramento, San Jose.
To this dance. I mean, I go and do research with the originals. I've been on tour with a lot of the originals from New York, you know what I'm saying? From the Bronx, where, you know, Wiggles, Ken Swift, you know what I'm saying? Fable. And I learn, because I'm a student, and I'm always gonna be a student.
It's been going on since 1991, Rock City anniversary. Buck Four had passed away, right? Buck Four is my best friend, so I wanted to keep his name alive, as well as Rashawn, Little Agar, Shy 147, all the members of Rock City that had passed away.
When we had our first Rock City anniversary, you know, in the park, our first official outdoor, that really got me back into it. You know, when I met people like Easy Rock, Gremlin, and the Japanese guys, you know, that really just got me hyped.
Big boy, big girl.
Black's anniversary, I just went to go pay respects to Mecca just to have fun. And then when I sat and listened to what they were saying, I understand more about myself, actually listening to what they were saying, why I had my mentality the way I did, why my drive inside was the way it was, what brought me to New York.
I like what's going on now, and I hope that this can continue every year. I'll be here 90 years old. It's my turn.
If it wasn't for battling.
The whole thing was to burn your opponent.
That's what makes it fun. I mean, it also helps the males to get off some of that testosterone, because if not, somebody might be hitting somebody else upside their head.
If a person cannot handle themselves in a battle, they don't deserve to call themselves a B-boy.
And it became ridiculous. Now that's how the dancing got amazing.
Self-challenge, really. When you really look into it, it's a challenge of how well you're going to do under pressure.
Of this whole culture that made it excel.
I'm everywhere. I'm at every gym. You won't be at a gym without seeing me.
Everybody's the next. What's next? Radiotron next. This event next. What's next?
Hip hop is, out of all things, it's very important to maintain your individuality. Yes, there's a lot of times you can see a bunch of heads dancing, but the ones that you will remember are the ones that may have bitten a move, but when inviting that move, they advanced it and took it to a different level and made it their own move.
Which means don't hang on the venue.
even when I was doing my videos, the company was like, we don't need that, we don't want that in the video. They wanted to put a bunch of girls behind me, and they were forgetting about the true essence of hip-hop. So when I seen KRS-One bringing it back, I was like, yo, hip-hop is back. The culture is back in full effect.
So what do I do? I say, okay, you know what? I'm not gonna say fuck y'all. Let me give you a puppy. Let me give you the girls singing in the chorus. Let me give you all this shit, because that's what y'all want. Then when I flash the video, let me show you these breakers. Let me show you these, let me show you this graph real quick, boom. And when you show it, they go, oh shit. Oh, that shit is hot. Oh, that shit is hot. Then they go, how successful is it? Is it gold? Does everyone else feel the way I feel? Yeah, Chris is gold. Oh, shit, it's dope. Now all the videos got breaking it. But we knew this. We all sat around. We said, yo, after we do this, everybody gonna wanna put breakers in their videos again.
I think Lex has done his part to keep that vibrant, even in big videos like Wyclef's video, Staying Alive, where you have, you know, the original members of Rocksteady, and you have kids who've been popping and b-boying for a long time in New York in the video, man.
I incorporate b-boying as far as like the music and shit. Anything that's b-boy that makes you just wear the hat, the old school book bags on the back of your back, you know what I'm saying, sagging your shit, that's b-boying all the way down from the breaking on the popping and locking.
B-boying didn't disappear, it's bigger than it ever was. It's just that they're underground.
It's kids doing this now, a whole new generation of kids that they ain't even supposed to be into this, and overseas too.
Yo, it's me, Speicher, and I'm having a lot of fun here at the Rocksteady anniversary. This is like very cool, but it's very different to Europe. The circles, they are different to Germany. Like in Germany, there's still a lot of gymnastics and gymnastics, and here they do more crowd pleasing stuff. And I love that. When I go back to Germany, I would practice a lot of that crowd pleasing stuff because it's so cool in the circle, and the people here go yeah, yeah all the time. I love it.
When we throw our Rocksteady thing, it's not only for the neighborhood, it's international. You know, we have Paris Breakers, people from London, Italy, even guys in Denmark. It just opens my eyes and like say, welcome to the family of B-Boys.
There's a meeting that happened in 1987. Afrika Bambaataa had a round table discussion, and he said to all of us, he said, you know, the humanism in hip hop, and how it shouldn't remain a black thing, a Latino thing. This was Bam. He caught a lot of flack for saying that. And Bam was always, from day one, Zulu Nation was always about, come on, everybody, come on in this. And it's not about race or color. It's about skill and ideology.
Thus came the idea of starting a Zulu Nation that would start out first in the black and Latino community, but then become a worldwide community with many different nationalities, religions, and many truths.
I'm glad that the rest of the world is enjoying and being a part of this.
I like Europe in the way that they preserve the culture in its, you know, its entirety with all the elements together. You know, the Battle of the Year, for instance, I mean, that was like, it blew my mind going there, and just, there was just riders and b-boys and MCs and everybody just mingling together, and it was like so many people, it was crazy.
I met so many people. I met people from Japan, didn't know English, respected them because I danced. I didn't know people from London, England. I didn't know people from Switzerland. I don't know. I met everybody in Germany. From even Indiana.
I travel, you know what I'm saying? Cats, yo, they breaking in the streets. They got the linoleum, you know, just like it was Wildstyle. You know, like it was 1982.
You know, the last time I was in Japan, they had a breakdance competition. I mean, this shit was the real deal. Just incredible shit.
I was just in England in Folkestone at a big hip-hop convention. Well, I was shocked when I saw there was two or three crews from Hungary alone. There were crews from Croatia.
We was over to Germany, we was over to Poland, we was over to Japan.
Yeah,
You know what I'm saying? During our show, they break dancing and they doing it. You know, I meet people over there in Europe that say, yo, I'm flying in on September for the Rocksteady reunion.
There's 100 times more, 100 times more. If there were 3,000 kids b-boying back in the early 80s, there are 300,000 kids doing it now.
Breaking is an incredible dance that's valid, it has foundation, it has vocabulary, there are names for all the moves. You know, it's not someone throwing themselves on the ground.
Nowadays, the dance has branched out so much. You know, you got the original b-boy style and footwork, you have the power moves, so sometimes you got brothers with b-boy moves, you know, real original techs, going up against guys with power moves that hardly have no b-boy techs. How are you gonna judge that? The neutral people that don't know anything might go for the power moves because it's really dynamic.
5 years ago, when I came here, everybody had backpacks with a helmet hanging from it, and they were breaking without sneakers, or some of them were breaking with sneakers, but all they were doing were flare windmills in 90s. Not many people had the foundation down. Not many people did footwork. Not many people hit freezes.
It's like if you go to an audition, a jazz dancer coming to a b-boy audition, you know, just because he could do those continuous backspins, which the commercial public knows as windmills, you know, just because he could do that doesn't mean that he's a b-boy. He's just an idiot that learned how to spin on his back. He has no style, no flavor, no feel for it.
So there is a beat and there is a rhythm to this music. It isn't about how dynamic your move is, but it's about like the feeling that you can express with the dance. Dance is about expression, and a lot of people have seemed to have forgotten that.
All the spinning is dope. I ain't knocking it, it's dope. But you need the style and the finesse. And when they b-boy back in the days, it was with a, you know, it was. You could see it in their bones and their face. You could see it in their body. You gotta get that charisma back in there.
Now, as a b-boy, I'm still trying to be competitive. I think b-boying represents you trying to dig deep to find something that you haven't seen done, which is very hard.
I mean, there's no difference from like Ken Swift or like Baryshnikov. You know, some things that I've seen a lot of these breakers do is just like, that is nuts.
True dancers, whether you're from tap or ballet or modern or jazz, they look at it as an art form already. I mean, they see it and they're like, wow, I mean, that's incredible.
I don't know one class nationwide in America that's not teaching street dance. At every formal dance studio, you read the list and I have street dance in there.
I'm creating this brand new dance academy, the Debbie Allen Dance Academy. And I actually had a young man here teaching break dancing, specifically that, because it is unique unto itself. It is a technique like ballet, like African, like hip hop.
Was the good foot. James Brown doesn't even know the effect that his music and style of dance had on people in the Bronx.
He was probably inspired by people he saw, tap dancers.
Them tappers back in the old days, them fools was like b-boys in a sense, you know what I mean? I mean, them fools is dope, they didn't give a
fuck. You wanna be technical, Sammy Davis Jr. was a b-boy.
Our favorites, no question, other than James Brown's, was they were brothers, the Nicholas brothers.
Some of it came from Lindy Hoppin. Then if you look at Frosty with the backflips, you can see all the Kung Fu influence. Ken Swift told me that the Muggsy, I asked him where'd he get it from, and he said Bruce Lee.
Curly from the Harlem Globetrotters. Put his one hand on the floor, and he used to run around bouncing a basketball.
I was into gymnastics. I used all my creativity and tried to focus it into the dance. Moves that were invented years before that we never saw, like the capoeira moves, somehow ended up in breaking.
Capoeira is the art form of fight dance. Breakdance is fight dance, is what it really is.
We've never seen capoeira, just like they never saw us dance. It definitely didn't come from another country. It was made up in the Bronx.
Don't nobody really know. It's some old human thing. The feeling to want to get on the ground and spin and dance and really become one with the earth, with the ground. Imagine before concrete, you was breaking and spinning on earth.
I like to see more of the top MCs out there in the world coming together with the top graph writers, the top B-boys, and the top DJs like it used to be. Use graffiti writers to do their album covers, not these computer graph artists that don't know jack about graph. Use real B-boys as their dancers and don't put them in the background, put them in the front.
I think the B-boys need to take it in their own hands. Need to take it in their own hands and need to bum rush hip hop. You know what I'm saying? Need to be like, you ain't rapping if you don't have B-boys. Don't talk about hip hop and then you got booty dancers behind you. What's that? Where's your hip hop at? I don't really want it to blow up on the mainstream. I don't want to be having people, you know, in suits coming over here telling us, okay, now you need to have form. If you can freeze and point your toe, it look just a little bit better. Nah, man, it's gotta be raw. You know what I'm saying?
Starting Wild Style, Busy B, Cold Crush, you know, What a Bed, Kevy Kev, and a bunch of the original heads from the movie came out and all, you know, did a little performance, and the Rocksteady crew danced. And when the Rocksteady crew went into the audience, they were surrounded by a lot of West Coast breakdancers. Black, white, Latino kids from Los Angeles. And they started dropping down to the floor and doing their thing, and it was so incredible. I felt exactly the same way I did when I first saw breakdance. Hey, the Rocksteady crew now, they have organized themselves, they have their politics correct, they have their business in effect, you know, and they know how to articulate, direct, and control this form, which is what has brought it back to the form that it is now. It's what has made this form translate to so many different cultures and people.
If you make a hip-hop Hall of Fame, Rocksteady would have to be up in there. I definitely get them that honor if I could do it myself.
I think that we need to let people know what's up, man. I don't want people to take these dances into the next millennium, some different whole vibe and feel and origins. You know, I think that it's important to teach the people about where these dances came from and how people felt, you know, so they can take it on to the next level with a respect for the
blood, sweat, and years that a lot of breakers have put into to develop this whole foundation for these people to live off of now.
All the B-boys all over the world, keep doing what you're doing, because we're the past, you're the future, and we put it all together, it's the present.
The cycle has begun. Styles always start once, they go out of style, and then all of a sudden, people get back to the root of things.
Rocksteady's gonna keep going strong. I think I'm gonna be in a wheelchair saying, "Yes, I'm Rocksteady. Yeah, Crazy Legs, come on, let's get busy."
We want to thank y'all for coming out to the Rocksteady 223rd anniversary. If y'all want to go out there and buck wild, it's a little up rock steps right now. We want y'all to do it out there with us. Ready? Oh.
A lot of people say, like, you know, what we do is played out, but you don't hear that about ballet and modern dance. If that was the case, we wouldn't still be doing this. Nobody would still be doing it.
If it's recognized by the president and the National Grants Institution for Dance or whatever, they cannot recognize it for the rest of eternity. And as long as kids are still battling and still dancing, to me, that's what's important.
We have to eliminate all of these labels and titles and stuff and just see it for what it is, man. We're all creating art in the ghettos, you know what I'm saying? And all over the world now.
It's up to us, we're the younger generation, because we right now, we are part of a movement. We are part of an underground young culture movement.
I mean, it's not a fact, something that you can't get rid of. I mean, it's always there, and it's always gonna be there.
Off the top of the dome, just creating.
B-boy is B-boy anywhere you go, any planet, any universe, any galaxy.
I see it as such a part of the culture that those who want to really stay true to the culture, they're gonna always, it's always going to be great dance.
They don't stop the B-boys or the big girls. They say, whatever you throw at us, we're going to make our dance be known and we're going to invade your club.
I knew it was gonna stay. I knew from the way it just all blew up from the music. You can never stop that. That's something that's in our blood, in our blood, in our blood.
Let's pop it and break into Davis done. Jigs, radic, acrobatic, automatic, back at it with the rising sun. A curve, perpendicular to the nearest circular. Preferred move to her run. Here he come to get him, son. Tick-tocking and socking, dominating the stocking. You stopping and popping and breaking. They got you flocking while they're tucking. Just rockers, haters, chit-chatting and talking. Watching, planning and mocking. People jocking, and the people are talking. Still in the pocket, pop, locking the market. Locking the situation down from the underground. Just got clown, smile, smirk, frown. Turn the other way around. I suggest you walk away slow with your face down.
Sleeves, cap, flips, good. Go out the back door, for sure. See you, I can battle.